Kia ora koutou. Welcome to the Weave Your Magical World podcast. So we have a really amazing guest for you today. His name is Adam Tallamy, and him and I have been friends now for 8 or 9 years, and we do a lot of our healing work together, often because he's in the UK, and often it'll be in my morning and his evening, or my evening and his morning, because of the time differences, of course. And he is going to talk to you a little bit about the journey that we've been on together with our healing, also about the beautiful modality that we use called Feel It. And I also want to chat to you and let you know about one of the biggest shifts that I've had in my life, one of the most profound, amazing, I don't know, results, I guess you want to say, from doing the Feel It work. And so yeah, we're gonna have a little corridor, a little talk about those things today. So it's gonna be maybe more of a chat, kind of informal talk, rather than like a formal interview, I suppose. So anyway, first of all, I want to introduce Adam. So Adam, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you, Penny. Pleasure.
Oh, I mean, we chat every day, pretty much anyway. So this is probably quite normal for us. So just a little bit of background about Adam. So you came from a corporate background, and then you had a bit of an event that happened that led you into healing. Could you just start and just give us a brief kind of rundown of that?
So I ran a recruitment business for about 14 years, and in 2008 I had a burnout, and I found myself at Leeds train station in the north of England, and I was on the way to a meeting there, and I suddenly thought I was having a heart attack. And it's quite amazing thing looking back on it to show you what my priorities were, because I thought I was having a heart attack, but my priority was I've got to get to this meeting. In fact, not just one, but I've got to go to two meetings, one with a bank and one with some insurance company. And I did the first meeting, got through that, met a colleague up there who'd come from Birmingham. And in the second meeting, I fell asleep with the HR director of quite a major bank. I then left my coat in his office, which was the far side of this huge building. And then I got to Leeds train station finally, and I just broke down in kind of tears and didn't know what was going on. All I knew was I had to get home, and went to A&E. Once I got back to London, my friend Emma met me there, and they said they checked everything. I had the ECG and everything, and they said, "No, it's not a heart attack. It's pleurisy, which is water on the lung, which has the same symptoms." But it was an amazing lesson looking back on it to see how skewed my life and my priorities were. And then I tried to go back to work the next day, thought I was fine, made it last about 2 hours, and then just ran out of energy. The energy just ran out of me, and slowly I realized that I just couldn't do it anymore. My body was telling me to stop. And that led me on this journey to start asking questions. Why was I doing what I was doing? Why was I running this business? And why was I kind of a bit of a workaholic? And the answers took me to quite a deep place. And 4 months, I couldn't even really get off the sofa. So all I could do was stop. And then I just went on this healing journey to try and get myself well to go back to work. But then, it just carried on and carried on. And years later, I'd sort of learned all these different tools and techniques and slowly became a coach and a healer myself. Quite the journey.
Definitely massive journey. And so how did you like start to kind of shift that? Like, what was your first thing that you like your first healing modality, or the first I don't know, support or help you received?
Well, to anyone not familiar, it will sound a bit out there, but I found this woman who just lived right around the corner from my mum's, where I'd gone back to kind of convalesce. And she was a crystal healer, and she taught other crystal healers. And I went to her workshop, and it was like I said a prayer. I'm not religious, but I said a prayer, and I found this thing online about 2 minutes later. And it was like, go to her. And she was just amazing. She was doing crystal healing, but she was also teaching about the soul and finding that deeper connection and the purpose of kind of life. And I just embraced it and probably became a bit of a zealot because I didn't have anything else to do. I had a big kind of hole in my life. And that was the first thing. I did that for a year or so. And then I got into something called Life Alignment, which is where you and I met originally. And that's an incredible healing modality, which you can apply it to your personal life, to your business, you can apply it to your home. I just love that. And I studied that for like, I don't know, did that years and years. I still do it now to a degree. And that's really powerful. So yeah, really, really amazing. Actually, I was so fortunate.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to bring on some Life Alignment practitioners to talk about that as well, because it's an important important modality for people to know about. Yeah. So this must have been quite a shift from becoming like this corporate business owner to being a crystal healer. Not something that you would have expected necessarily.
I think everyone literally thought I'd lost the plot, including myself. It's funny because I spent, I guess, about 2 or 3 years really learning that and getting into it and becoming a healer and starting to help people do that. And then I had this kind of voice in my head one day that just said, enough of that now, go back to work. And by that, like, go back to recruitment. And I was like, what? No way. Like, I was really angry. I was like, no, I'm not doing that. How could you trick me like this? All this range of emotions came up. And then I followed the guidance eventually. And I went back to recruitment and I did it for about 2 years, properly full time. I got a new office right in the middle of the city in London and built my business up again and was making really good money again. I kind of proved to myself, I had to prove to myself that I could do it and that I hadn't become this kind of basket case, you know, wearing tie-dye t-shirts and incense, which I still am, obviously. But what it helped me do was it helped me have one foot in the spiritual very firmly and one foot in the business world. So I wasn't too out there and now I can really kind of seamlessly work between both areas, which I think is actually a real blessing. And then I did the recruitment thing for about 2 or 3 years. And then the guidance was, right, you're finished with that now. And it was really weird because I've been building it up and I've been doing really well and I had a business partner and stuff. And I had to turn around and say, look, I'm really sorry, I'm done, and walk away. And the business then kind of closed down gradually, went into runoff. But it gave me, I had a new, because we were recruiting contractors, so I had some people working through my company for about another year or two after that. So it gave me the money to be able to really focus then on my coaching business, which I then started to grow. Mm. So, yeah.
That would have been a shock to your business partner, right? Oh, by the way, we're closing down this successful business.
Yeah, it was a weird one. It was actually worked out perfectly for him. He ended up going to another company, which I think served him really well. He was there for like 5 years after that and grew a lot from it. So it always works out perfectly in the end. But yeah, it was a really difficult conversation to have. And I think that was partly why I had to do it, you know, especially because I then help entrepreneurs as well. So I've been through it. I've been through all the highs and the lows you can imagine with companies. I had to make people redundant. I've hired and grown really things really fast. Yeah. And then to understand through the work you and I do, to understand what the underlying kind of blocks and issues are, because that's the key, right? That's what you and I understand. It's if you're not having the success you want, there's an underlying deeper reason for that. And what I always used to think was, if you just work harder, if you just read the right self-help book or hire the right consultant to come in and help you, that will do the business for you. And to an extent that works, but if you've got an underlying belief that actually I'm not good enough, I don't deserve success, or you have a ceiling that you're not aware of as to how much money you can make, which everyone, by the way, does, then you're never going to get past that until you actually do the internal work.
Mm.
So really, if you only take one thing away from our conversation today, it's that there's a reason why you don't have what you want. And if you can admit that to yourself and go on a bit of an inner journey to find the answers, then you can change anything if you put in the time. And for me, really, I guess the last 10 years have been about taking that journey, and you as well, and going inside and finding out what those blocks are. And it never ceases to amaze me the things that come up. We're going to talk about this later, but it's both the stuff that happened in childhood, it's our own beliefs and patterns. What was the family pattern? What's the ancestral pattern coming through? Is it of struggle and strife, or is it that everything's just easy and comes to you? In which case, that's probably what you're going to experience. For me, it was struggle and strife, and yeah, you can have success, but you've got to really work super hard and kill yourself. Mm-hmm. Hence the burnout, right? And then you've got the other aspects, which are, and again, this might sound a bit woo-woo if you've not experienced it, but the past life thing comes up a lot. And I would never have believed in past lives. I didn't even believe in spirituality or didn't know anything about it. And I remember being asked this question, like, you know, when you do one of those wheel of life things where they say, right, well, on a scale of 0 to 10, how good are you in business at the moment? How good are you with finance? And the last question on the list was, you know, where are you with spirituality? And I was like, I didn't know what that meant. And I wrote 0.
Wow. So different. So different.
Yeah. So, you know, I had to kind of, no wonder I had to wake up. And that was what the burnout did for me, is it forced me in my tracks to stop. Greatest gift that ever happened to me. And I knew that within about a week of it happening. It was like, no, this is happening for a reason. And that was like, it was just like this calming sort of sense that actually, no, this is good.
I mean, this is something that I've always found with you, is that your guidance is very strong and very clear and very direct. And so it's interesting just talking about that now, of how strong it was before you were even into spirituality.
Yeah, true. Yeah, true. Well, I mean, it only started literally at that point. So I had the burnout, and then but prior to that, I didn't have any intuition at all. Not really. Didn't even know what it meant.
Mm.
If that gives hope to someone out there listening to this who's like, what on earth are they talking about? It's like, anyone, when the time's right, you'll get it.
Yeah. And so that is a belief that we share, definitely, that intuition is not privy to a certain few. It is something that we all have within us. It's just a matter of allowing that to come.
Yeah. Absolutely. And part of it is getting still. And actually, one of the first things that happened when I had the burnout is I just got the intuition I need to start to meditate. And that is the most important thing you can do if you want to develop your intuition, is just get yourself. And it doesn't have to be really hard. Most people say, oh, I could never do that, sit there without thinking. It's like, no, that's not the idea. That's what stops people doing it or makes them think they can't do it. So no, everyone has stuff pop into their head when they're meditating. That's the point. The thing of meditation is just catch yourself when those things come up. I get loads of things, like the shop was shopping, what I'm having for tea, oh, I feel a bit cold, or oh, I've got an itchy nose, you know, all of that. And you just catch yourself, smile inwardly, and think, oh yeah, I'm meditating, great. And then you just come back to the breath and just follow the breath in, coming in and out of the nose. That's all it is. And just that will help you still yourself, but it will also, what most people don't understand is it will start to improve your intuition. That's one thing. And the other thing it does is it's the light that you breathe in, it kind of comes in as you meditate, that will start to show you the issues or the things that are blocking you currently. So they'll start to come to the fore more to allow you to clear them, which you can do once you've got a few tools and you know what you're doing.
I like that, the light that you breathe in.
Yeah. Very few people seem to talk about that with meditation.
I don't think they do. Can you just expand on that a little bit?
So the whole point is, in an ideal world, you're sitting meditating with your back straight and you're breathing, you can do it in different ways, but either you focus just on the breath coming in here. So if you breathe in sharply, you'll feel it in your nostrils. And then if you breathe in right to the top of your nose, you'll feel it at the top of the nose inside there. And when you're meditating, you just focus on the breath. So you focus on it coming out of the nose, on the nostrils, and then coming in at that point. And if you imagine that you're breathing in white light, either through the nostrils, or you can imagine you're breathing it in through the crown, and just let that light come in. I mean, by the way, you're gonna be bringing the light in anyway, even if you're thinking about it or not, just because you're getting super still. And it's that stillness. In fact, I watched a podcast about this today. The guy was talking about, what did he call it? Sacred stillness, I think. Now that sounds a little bit like something really special. It's not. It's just get still, and that will allow the guidance and the intuition to start to come to you. And meditation is the best way to do that. And if you can get in a habit, my suggestion would be set your alarm clock every morning. Try and do it roughly the same time, even if that's just when you wake up. Get in that habit. And, you know, I don't have to do it as much anymore. I don't seem to need it as much. But for years and years and years, I'd meditate every day. Part of it is with the feeler is you meditate in the morning, or you just check in and go, right, is there anything specific I need to do today? And most of us are kind of programmed to be rushing around and getting busy, and the ego, but it's finding out that actually it's the ego is driving most of that stuff. 99% of what we do is completely irrelevant. We don't need to be doing it.
Now, we don't actually know that it's driven by ego, because it becomes so normal or so accepted as just how we operate as human beings. And so I think what is really powerful, and we're going to talk about this more in a second and what feel it is, but what's so powerful about it is you actually do get to, like you said, those underlying causes or reasons why we do certain things and why we drive ourselves, like you did, into burnout. And we like keep pushing and keep pushing when we're ultimately actually not fulfilled or happy when we do that. But what I want to draw our attention to now is a little bit about our journey with Feel It Together and how we first met. Now, you said it was through life alignment, which is a modality that both of us studied for many years, and it is beautiful and powerful, but we'll go into that another episode. I remember we were at a Christmas party for life alignment, and we were talking about, I don't know, there was me, you, and one other person, and we were talking about who, like, oh yeah, you guys seen anyone, blah, 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 what's going on in your life kind of thing. And this must have been like the second time I'd ever met you or something. And then, yeah, I mean, what's your memory of that? Do you want to share your memory of that?
Or do you want me to share my memory of that? So Penny was like, yeah, I'm dating someone, I'm seeing someone. I was like, oh, cool. Who is it? And she goes, oh, it's a Kiwi guy. And obviously this was in London, by the way. And I was like, oh, great. What, is he in London as well? You're like, oh, no, he's in New Zealand. I'm like, oh, okay. And have you been together long? And basically it kind of came out that you were sort of together, but you weren't really together and you hadn't seen him properly. And he was going to maybe move to London. And I've never seen anyone look so white as a sheet, scared about the prospect of meeting the person they're sort of with as you. And I said, we might want to do a bit of work on that.
Yeah, I'd met this guy on a holiday in Greece, and we'd maintained some semblance of a friendship relationship on Skype. that's how long ago it was. Skype was the thing. You were like, oh yeah, you're looking forward to him coming to London? apparently that's when I turned white. And I think the interesting thing is that I was absolutely 100% a commitment phobic, but had no idea at all. And it took me a while to be convinced of that, I think, as well. Because in my mind, all I wanted was to be in this beautiful, loving relationship. But when the reality of that came near, I did everything I possibly could to push that away. And so anyone I felt connected to, like this guy was a lovely human, but he did live like as far as you could possibly get away from where I lived. And so that was safe. We used, you and I started then working together because you had similar issues. I like to point out. And what was that?
Maybe a tiny bit.
Maybe a tiny bit. Yeah. And so I absolutely 100% know, and I know you do as well, that I would never, ever have got into a healthy relationship had it not been for the work that we were doing, that we have been doing. And I believe that my journey perhaps took longer because that I'm a coach and a healer, and because I really needed to understand this work very deeply in order to be able to teach it to somebody else and to help other people ignite this work in their lives. And I know you and I often joke about how it, when the people that we work with, our clients, seem to get this so much quicker. But they're jumping in our jet stream, right? That's just what happens. When you work with somebody, they jump in your jet stream and they receive the benefit of that healing. So that's a beautiful thing. It's just funny. It's like, yeah, that took me a long time.
So how long did it take you to work through that stuff to get into a healthy relationship?
So now I'm in this like beyond amazing relationship, which I think about it like the relationship that I used to think that I wanted, I used to think that was maybe like a 12 out of 10, you know, a bit impossible. And now I look at what I wanted then, that was like a 4 out of 10, maybe a 3 out of 10. And where I'm at now is like, I don't know, beyond, definitely beyond a 10 or 11 or 12 or whatever, which is, amazing. And so, yeah, it took a while. What was that, like, I don't know, 7 years or something to really work through stuff. And I did have relationships along the way, just not ones where people were in the same country as me, or not ones that lasted that long, and definitely relationships that I wasn't able to be my full self. So I felt there was always a part of me I needed to hide. And I wasn't really letting myself connect with people who were kind of igniting all of my heart, because that was very much blocked away and locked away. We worked a lot on things. So when I was 19, my dad died, and we worked a lot through that kind of stuff, because that brought up a lot of, if my dad can't even stick around, then how am I possibly worthy of anybody else sticking around, kind of thing, which is ridiculous because my dad was this amazing human, loved me very much. So it makes no rational sense. Some belief like this living inside me, but it was influencing my decisions that I made around relationships all the time. And it was just, I had this massive hand up going, nope, stay back. Whereas if I thought that it was someone that I wasn't going to fall in love with, I was like, okay, that's fine. We can hang out for a bit because I know that I'm never going to end up obliterated in this, you know, space where you're going to leave me, as ultimately you will, because that's what happens in my life, because that's what I've seen happen.
Yeah. That was huge, actually. And for anyone who's been through that, where they've lost a parent, especially of the opposite sex, even though you probably think, oh, no, that doesn't apply to me, on some level, the chances are it will be playing out somewhere. Because you didn't think it had any bearing, right, until it started coming up.
Yeah, I mean, especially when I started training in life alignment, because, you know, things like that keep coming up. And I'm like, oh, not again. I've fixed that. I've dealt with that.
Yeah, that didn't work last time. What's going on? You hear that so many times.
Yeah, yeah. And so it's just working through those layers and getting used to those layers. Now I'm in this incredible relationship, which I'm going to bring him on and chat to him at some stage as well. We knew each other we were friends for 3 years. And so we've got this beautiful connection, and we've seen each other grow so much over that time. It just keeps getting better and better all the time. I'm just smiling because I know I'm going to see him today. I want to talk a bit more about Feel It and what it is, and and what its potential is. So can you talk about how you first came across Feel It, like who introduced you to it? Because I often feel like you and I initially you took me through like an internship of learning this stuff. I know I was a little resistant. I wasn't the most well-behaved student. But yeah, we'll get to that. So do you want to talk a little bit about the origins of Felix?
Mm. So my friend, Vineet Bhatia, he taught me the process initially, which he called emotional acceptance. And what we've done, I'll talk to you about what the process is. It's super simple, but so powerful. And you can use it to change virtually anything, no matter how big, deep the issue or trauma is. And what we've done over the years is we've kind of added to that, and we've taken bits from all over, from life alignment. We've taken different aspects. We've taken some past life sort of approaches, taken some ancestral family healing from family constellations, and we've kind of morphed it all together. And really, it's whatever you need is now in the toolkit. And we can get to the root of pretty much anything. And it's all playing out. So I know with Penny, she had a number of sort of past life things that had happened in with regard to men, and that was definitely playing out. There was the thing with her father, but then there were other sort of more distant relatives, sort of ancestral type patterns that were playing out for you as well, all of which were having an impact on you meeting a man, right?
Yeah.
So in terms of feel it or emotional acceptance, it's basically you identify in a nutshell, sounds so simple. You're going to go, what are you talking about? You identify how you feel about a certain issue. So let's say if it's, the opposite sex, you're thinking about a relationship and you think actually,
or it could be the same sex as well, if that's what you're
doing. Or same sex. True. You might have kind of a feeling of resistance comes up when you think about getting together with someone, or it might be a fear, or it might be a nervous energy, and whatever that feeling is, if it's a negative feeling, that's something that you're going to want to pay attention to and work through. And how you do that using feel it is quite simply you identify where you feel that in the body. Could be the head, the stomach, the heart. Could be your little toe, could be all over, could be nowhere at all. And you basically scan your body and you say, okay, so yeah, I sort of feel that in my stomach is quite a common one. And then you sort of, you know, close your eyes, feel that a little bit. And you're like, right, how intense is that feeling on a scale of 0 to 10? And let's say it's a 6 or an 8. So then you close your eyes and you just feel that energy and you sit with the feeling, not the story, you come right into the feeling. And you just feel that until it gradually starts to reduce and dissipate until it gets down to a 0. And then there might be another layer. So you clear that. And that on average kind of takes 2 to 5 minutes, I'd say. But it can take much longer. It can take half an hour on occasion. And you just have to sit with it and keep feeling it. And you can do that kind of cross-legged with your eyes closed. Or you can do it actually as you go about your day. If you're on the bus or something, you can just sort of feel it in the background. And the more practiced you get, the more you'll get used to doing it all the time. Personally, I'm sort of feeling something virtually all the time. Like even at the moment, I'm sitting here, there's a slight sort of thing in my stomach, to give you an example. It's a feeling of not good enough. So it's like, oh, I've got to do better. I've got to perform. And it's a 4 out of 10. So I'm just sort of in the background without really even thinking about it. I'm just feeling that and it will go down and get to a 0. And then I'll feel much more relaxed. But that's it in a nutshell. How would you describe it?
Yeah. I mean, a similar kind of way, I guess, the one thing I want to bring into that is that whoever we're working with as a client, they kind of make it their own as well. And so different elements that kind of intuitively channeled, if you want to use that word, into the process as well. And so different kind of things come up, different, like, I think you and I are both quite big on different getting like visions of what intuitively needs to come in, and it can just shift the energy so much. And so it's an emotional process, it's an energetic process, it's a ancestral, like it's so big. And whenever we work with new people, just new things come into it all the time. And so I feel like it's this, this vortex, it draws incredible things into it. But yeah, getting a handle on that basic technique will kind of bring and draw whatever your healing gifts are to you. I was talking to a new friend just the other day, and she sees colors, which is kind of very similar to maybe the colors of your chakras. And she sees, as soon as she sort of goes into a meditative state, she gets these colors that come up. And so I haven't had a chance to work with her yet, but this is just a new kind of way of her kind of gifts and talents coming through that's going to help her heal her own life first and foremost, and then if she's guided to help other people as well.
The thing that I love about the feel it process is that it empowers you as the client or as the individual to do so much for yourself. Because even if you're paying to see a coach or a healer once a week or once a month, that's only like an hour or 2 hours once a week or once a month. It's not going to it's going to be great. You're going to clear some stuff. It's not going to move you forward that fast. Mm-hmm. Whereas with this, very quickly, you're going to learn how to do a lot of this for yourself. And what you and I try and do is teach our clients how to do that so that they can then start to do it every day, because then you're going to move forward seven, you know, if you're doing it once a week and or seven times a week instead of once a week, you're going to move forward seven times faster, right? And actually you can do it even more so that you're working on it two, three, four times a day. So you're talking about massively moving forward in such a more productive way.
Absolutely. And that was the big shift in my life, was when I started working with you, is that's when I actually, because I would see other healers and I would go to courses and I would go to workshops and I would have sessions with people. But my life didn't really start shifting until I took that responsibility for myself on a day-to-day basis. That's a game changer. Like, that's such a big shift, because then you start to notice less and less. Like, I used to have annoying little things that happened all the time. I remember when I was in London receiving like a ticket on a train because I'd just forgotten to get my ticket when I changed trains, and I actually hunted down the conductor to buy my ticket and everything, and he was just really mean and rude to me, and I was just like, oh my god, like I'm a good person, I'm trying to pay my ticket kind of thing, and I just got really upset. But it was like I had this energy of not deserving money, so I kept losing it through different things like that would happen all the time that just don't happen anymore. And like things would irritate me or upset me, or people would say something to me, and I just don't have those experiences anymore.
Yeah, you add the more work you do, you gradually become sort of stronger and more emotionally balanced. You'll still get triggered, but you'll be able to deal with it much, much quicker. And most things would just be like water off a duck's back. Mm. That's the beauty of this work. And it's the path of self-mastery. And what that means is you gain control over your thinking and over your emotions so that you can focus on what it is that you want to bring into the world. Mm. And that's where we then start to get into manifestation. It's like you can be doing, for anyone who's into manifestation or the law of attraction, it's like you can do your visualization to the, create an amazing business and make lots of money. But if you've got all those blocks that are in the way, one, you need to clear those. And two, you've got to get yourself balanced enough emotionally and mentally so that you can stay focused on that vision, no matter what's going on around you, and keep coming back to it. And that's been a big part of the journey as well, right? For both of us. It's clearing as we go and keep coming back to visualizing what we really want.
Yeah. And interestingly enough, both of us have this inability now to do anything that's not from a space of joy or that really we feel is right or guided to do. And so I'm just looking at, that's one of your paintings behind you, that you got really into manifestation art, and it's beautiful. And so can you tell us a little bit about that particular painting and what manifestation art is?
So manifestation art is basically what I do is I set an intention. I write that on, I kind of meditate and get what wants to come through. And it used to be things that I wanted to bring into my life, like more money or things like that. But now it's more focused on what wants to come into the world. And that particular painting is about freedom. And what I do is, so I'll write the intention. So it might be, let there be more freedom in the world, for example. That could be the intention. And then what I do is I start to paint. But what happens is all the blocks in me all the parts of me that don't feel free will come up over the next few weeks or month. And I'll start to paint those out. So when I get into an emotional state, I'm like, oh, I'm so trapped. It's almost asking for trouble, because you write the intention, then immediately the opposite starts to happen. And you're like, you're pulling your hair out, going, oh, I'm stuck. I can't get out of here. It's dead end. Nothing's ever going to change. Da, da, da. And what I do is I get really angry, paint it all into the painting, like, and then gradually, as you get more of the emotions out, you start to come into a place where you feel a bit more free. And then finally, normally after like a month to 2 months, I get to a place where I do feel that freedom inside. And then the last few strokes are literally me bringing that into balance. And I sometimes show you the painting and say, when you tune into that painting, what do you get? And if it's only halfway, she'll go, ooh, feels a bit off, you know, feels a bit like you're not very free or something like that. And then by the end, it kind of balances it out. And then it just carries this really nice energy. So I don't know, it's something, if you're intuitive, you can just sort of sit and feel into it. But each painting is very different and has a different energy.
What I also find is really interesting, because I've felt this from your paintings that were finished as well. If it was something unhealed in me as well, that painting will trigger me until I balance it.
Got it. And by the way, that's the purpose, really. It's the paintings tend to find buyers who get triggered, or they get really drawn to it one way or the other. Some people actually really viscerally have a real negative, like, oh, that painting, can't even look at it. And that's then the painting that they need, because it carries all the energy in the journey of coming from that negative state to the positive. And then what they need to do is kind of have it, and just have it on the wall in a very prominent place for a few months, two to six months, something like that. And that will then bring up the same sort of stuff in them. They'll have the experiences in their day-to-day lives that will come up in order for them to heal it as well. And I do commission. So if people want to set their own intention specifically, they can then do that, and we'll discuss it, and I'll paint in all of that into the painting. That's really powerful as well. I just love doing it, to be honest. And what it does in a bigger picture is it raises awareness of the power of, one, of intention, two, that you can manifest, but three, the big part is no one's really talking about the need to clear the blocks. You know, so many people talk about the law of attraction and manifestation, but very few are talking about the clearing work. That's the biggest piece. Anyone can sit there and visualize, I don't know, getting a new house, but just because you've done that, you ain't going to get it. Like, unless you happen to be very, very aligned, which I would say is unlikely, because otherwise that wouldn't be the thing you'd be most drawn to. It'd be something else that's going to take you on the journey to heal yourself. Otherwise, what's the point? The universe gets this big carrot. It dangles it in front of you. It's like, I want that carrot. I want that carrot. Oh, great. What you have to do is face your stuff. Oh, okay. I'll do that. And otherwise, you wouldn't do it in a million years, because it's too hard.
Yeah.
So it'll be a nice car, it'll be something you really want.
Yeah. And I think also, because I was talking about this at the beginning, that the relationship was the thing that I always wanted. But I used to want it from a place of, I'm not good enough and I need validation. And so I need that relationship, and I need to be this sort of person so that I look good enough, and so that I realize, so they end up believing in me and teaching me all the things that I secretly knew were inside me, but I didn't actually believe were there. And then I had to go through this massive phase of actually coming into like deep self-love and connection with myself. And I think the self-love isn't black or white. It's a continuum, because I'm going to love myself more in a month than I do now, and in 5 years more than I did in a month's time. But my God, where I am now is such a beautiful place, and especially compared to where I was when we first met, and I'm just, you know, dating these guys that are pretty, and I'm not really connected to in any way. No disrespect to them, because they would have been on their journeys.
You make a really good point there, and it's that actually you have to get to a place where you feel like you've got that energy, because it's not the partner that you want actually, it's that you want to feel loved.
Yep.
Right? You want to feel the happiness that that will give you. But to actually to truly manifest it and for it to last, you've got to have got to a place where you feel that already about yourself. Then it can come in and then it will be effortless. And that person will love you and they will make you, you'll be happy and love yourself already. That will just be the cherry on the top of a beautiful cake.
Yeah.
And it's the same with everything, whether it's the house or whatever. For the house, you'd have to feel like you're living a really great life and you've got everything that you want. And you're happy with what you've got, even if it's a pokey little flat in the back end of nowhere. Doesn't matter. You've got to get to a place where actually, yeah, you can want more, but you don't, you need to have deleted the kind of need more to fill a hole.
The difference between wanting and needing is huge.
It's huge. That's what you did. Yeah. You erase that button and fill the hole in yourself.
Yeah. And it's interesting because I see that continuing to happen now that I'm in my relationship. It's like a magical like growth and connection to myself, which I didn't realize a relationship could be. Like I didn't know they could be this good, which is
that's nice.
Yeah.
So what advice would you give to someone who perhaps is listening to this, who is back where you were 8-9 years ago?
And all right,
they want to get into that sort of relationship. Where do they start? What are they, you know, other than coaching with you, you know, what's the key?
I think the key is to discover, you know, if they really do want that, just start. And so it's really about surrender, I think. And once you kind of start to be like, honest with yourself, like how do you really feel and how do you think you're gonna feel if you're with that partner that you think you need, right? Because once we get something, we're gonna feel the same. So like, you know, people go, I just need to move to a different place or a different house or whatever. You're not all of a sudden gonna feel different because you've moved country or you've moved to a different city or whatever. The feelings you have inside are the feelings you have inside. And they can temporarily change a little bit because you're in a different environment, of course. And you know, but that environment's not gonna be a huge amount better unless you've changed your internal environment. So I don't know, let's say if I'd bottled it and gone and married like a really wealthy man that I didn't love or something, then initially it might be great because I've got this lovely, beautiful house and cars and clothes and all this kind of stuff. But it's very soon going to get old and I'm very soon going to be like, ugh, this feeling of not being good enough and not feeling worthy of these things. And I'll either end up losing it, like losing those things, or that feeling is going to follow me. And so when you think about the relationship that you want, it's about thinking, how do I want to feel? And whenever you start thinking, oh, I want them to make me feel this way. I want them to make me feel loved. I want them to make me feel good enough. I want them to make, you know, people to look at me this way or be respected this way. Then you realize you don't feel that way about yourself. And even if on a certain surface level you might, or yeah, I feel like I do, on a deeper level, you don't. And so it's about really, how do I want to feel? And then start to kind of be really real with yourself and to explore the fact, well, maybe I don't feel that way. And just start to move through those emotions. Because when you move closer to yourself, and that means allowing yourself to feel the things that are uncomfortable, that's that moving closer to yourself. But inside those same caves, if you like, that you explore that discomfort, you're also going to find your magic and you're going to find what you really love to do. And you're going to find your joy and the connection to you and the connection that you'll have to other people or other activities or things. And so it's like, there's no better journey, in my opinion, than to come closer and more connected to yourself. And this is what Feel It does. And this is why I have been able to bring in this magical, amazing, beautiful relationship and many other things. Like both you and I have changed our situations in our lives dramatically, and that's because we're just allowing those things to come in. Like you never would have let yourself be an artist before you know, and just And I know the joy you get from that. Like, it's palpable when you're like, you know, you've been painting and I can feel it in your end paintings. Like, you love that.
Yeah. So good. So I just reiterate what you started that with. It's like, you just need to start the journey and find a healer or a coach or someone to help you work on it. And you're very quickly, even if you've got no experience of working on yourself, it's like you will start to understand what we mean by that.
Yeah.
And once you get in the zone, it's almost like you take the red pill, you know, in the Matrix, you take the red pill, the blue pill, the red pill. Once you take that and you start, that's it. There's no going back. You're gonna keep working and you will eventually get there. Question is, how fast and how long is it going to take? And it all comes down to you, how much effort you're going to put in. And with tools like Feel It or whatever, you know, there are lots of different modalities you can apply, and maybe Feel It isn't the right one for you. I don't know. I personally have used lots of different techniques over the years, all of which have helped me in one way or another. And at times there's a need for different things. So just see what you get drawn to and get stuck into it. That would be my best advice.
Yeah. And I think that's beautiful advice. And both of us have used many different modalities. It's just Feel It has been the one that we use on ourselves every day consistently to support us getting to the lives that we want and that we love.
By the way, you underplayed it earlier. We Penny and I, because she's in New Zealand, I'm in London, like the time difference works quite well. It's like 11, 12 hours, depending on what the clocks are doing. So we literally are connecting twice a day, working for probably at least 2 hours a day, which to most people seems really extreme and off the wall. But that's, if you want to move forward fast, that's the way to do it. And then we're working on ourselves during the day, not when we're connecting together, but coming together with someone kind of allows you to your energy to be held, and you can see your own stuff clearer, and they're going to help you to work through it. So, you know, when the time is right, if that's your path, you'll find someone who can help you in a similar sort of way.
Yeah.
But initially, maybe it's just someone that you pay as a coach, or, you know, you meet someone like Penny and I did on a workshop, or somewhere along the line, the teacher comes when the student is ready, right? The famous phrase.
Yeah, there's always healing and support available. It's just we have to be open to that. And sometimes we have to just get that first little ounce of hope in order to be open to that. Like, I remember I was trying some sort of positive thinking thing before you and I connected. So that was enough to kind of give me like temporary shifts that I could actually connect with you. But, you know, ultimately I kept kind of dropping back in because I wasn't clearing my stuff. But yeah, it gave me enough to shift for us to meet and for us to do our work together and the life alignment stuff. So
yeah, same here. And different things will serve you at different times. So I studied NLP was the first thing I did, neuro-linguistic programming. And I got really into that. I was studying it. I did my advanced sort of thing and probably spent about a month in total studying it, and it was good, and it helped me open my eyes to different things and helped me a bit, but ultimately it was never going to do it. It didn't work and go to the right level for what I needed. So I then moved on to something else, and that thing was life alignment. So, the great thing about this journey is the unit, and you'll learn this in a real practical sense. It sounds a bit out there, but the universe has your back. The universe knows what you need to get to where you want. And the things that you need are going to come to you, be it, I don't know, healing modalities, be it the right teacher, but also the issues and the situations and the wrong partners who are going to trigger your stuff, that are going to show you what's there, what you need to work on. And sometimes, quite frankly, you need to get dumped in a relationship. You need to be rejected, because that's going to show the part of you that's terrified of being rejected and doesn't feel good enough. And none of it is wrong. And I hear this a lot, people saying, oh, it didn't work out with so-and-so. It was really sad. It's like, no, it did work out. It worked out perfectly, as long as you then go and do the work and grow from it and clear your stuff, because it helps you. One, it helps you feel better in yourself, ultimately. And two, it will help you focus in on, oh, I don't want that again. I want someone who's more like this. How perfect. Like, it couldn't be any better, right?
Absolutely. And I think that's something that I often say to my clients is there is no good and bad, because when you can look at things as preferred and less preferred, or comfortable and uncomfortable, because the discomfort, that's so often the things that bring us into the place we really want to be, when we can dive into that, because it's come up for a reason, right? And so instead of looking at, oh, I want to avoid any pain or any discomfort or anything like that, it's kind of like, well, let that come up, and then we can move through it and we can let it go, and it can help elevate us and help elevate our lives. And so it's, it's about embracing everything, because people talk a lot about the shadow, don't they? So it's embracing your shadow, which is both the discomfort of things that people generally call bad, but it's also embracing the discomfort of our magic that lives within us as well, and letting that come up.
Got it. Yeah. And it's not that you've got to go through necessarily 30 bad relationships before you crack it. It might be that you just need to take some time out and have a year where you don't date anyone until you get to a place where you feel like ready, and then the right person kind of shows up. But this, again, that's where you checking in, and we haven't talked much about this, but following the intuition and going into the heart and listening to the heart and your own guidance, that's going to tell you when you're ready to go and go on a date. And when that person comes in, you can check in. Should I be going on a date with this person? And actually, guess what? Sometimes the answer is going to be no way. They're a lunatic, And that will save you so much grief and headache and heartache.
So see, I had that. Do you remember? I had that exact same thing. So I was, because I'd been back in New Zealand, I've been back in New Zealand 4 years now. I don't know how long it was then. But leading up to when I met my partner now, I was like, seeing friends of mine being on dating apps and things like this. And I was like, oh, it looks like so much fun, and I want to do that. And I'd be like, shall I go on a dating app? My heart's like, no. It's like, if you want, but you wanted a nice story about how you met your partner. Do you really want to sacrifice that? My heart jokes with me a lot. And I'm just like, oh, man. And I was feeling like, because I was getting stressed, I'm like, what happens if we end up in lockdown again? I'm never going to meet anybody. And there was all of this like, but then I was just like, ultimately there was this undercurrent of calm. Everything's fine. I'm just like, I can't see anything externally. Like, it seems no possible way. Like, I'm not, when I go out just hanging out with my friends, and we kind of are in conversation, or I'm doing, going to events or something. It's not really like the place that I felt like I was going to meet somebody. And then, he was already there.
I remember just before you got together, you were freaking out. It was like, there's no way this is ever going to happen. Especially with the lockdown thing about to kick in. You were like, never going to meet. If we're going to lockdown, that's it. Game over. That's done. And then literally the next week, bang, it happened.
Yeah. But I think ultimately it was this surface level of panic, and the calm underneath was saying everything's fine. And ultimately my actions were trusting that, right? Because I didn't get on a dating app. I didn't go out when I felt like I didn't want to go out, just in case I met somebody. So my actions were speaking the truth, that I actually did trust that it was going to happen. I just couldn't see it on the outside. Like, my brain was kind of the one freaking out, going, logically, when are you going to meet somebody?
Yeah. And by the way, that's a big part of it. It's learning to trust your guidance and to trust that things are going to work out how they're meant to at the right time. And actually, trust is a muscle. It's not just having blind faith in something. It's actually a muscle. And what you do is, when you're going to come out of trust a lot on this path, because you're not going to see it with your eyes, what that partner that's there, maybe he'd been there for 3 years, but you didn't know that, right? But your intuition was like, just wait, it's going to be okay. It's going to work out. But that obviously fears and doubts and stuff come up. And it's you're never going to be in trust all the time. If you did, you'd be an ascended master. It's like, no, you're going to freak out a lot. And then what you're going to do is do feel it on the emotions that come up until you come back into a balanced place. That will bring you back into trust. And that's a big part of the journey, right? It's coming out of trust, coming back into trust, coming out, coming back. Otherwise, you'd have jumped on the dating app. You'd have gone out with the wrong person, but just because your ego was freaking out, right? So you've got to clear that, which you did many, many times. Great.
Yeah, and I always liken trust to balance, because when I used to train parkour a lot, balance was a really key element of that. And so we'd be walking along railings or whatever, and you're only training your balance if you're slightly off balance. So if you're kind of wobbling a little bit, if you're walking along, like, I don't know, something this wide, for me, that's not training my balance, because I'm not kind of, my proprioceptors are not having to kind of stabilize me all the time. And so if I want to increase my balance, I have to like make the platform or the surface I'm walking on smaller, or close your eyes, or do whatever you do to make it harder, right? But then that ultimately makes my balance even stronger. And that's the same with trust, as you allow your, yeah, and to trust yourself even more allows even greater things into your life.
And so
when
you got me doing parkour that one time, I think mine was about a meter wide was where I was finding my balance.
You were quite good at parkour. Your mobility was a bit not as great as it could be. But you were, I was actually impressed. I think you were quite good when we did that last year.
I didn't feel that myself, but okay.
So I thank you so much for your time this evening, for you, this morning for me. It's just been awesome. Obviously, I love talking about this stuff, and we have great chats all the time. And we'll probably talk again, because there's a lot in this. But yeah, I would really love if you could just let people know where they can find you if they're interested in. I mean, Adam is just probably the best coach I know, and he's amazing, and just so powerful. Like, you get such powerful shifts and changes. Like, I've seen you working with other people, I've seen you running workshops, and they're just incredibly powerful, like mind-blowingly powerful. And so if people want to contact you to do some coaching or healing work, or if people want to get a manifestation art, like, how can they find you?
Great. Thank you for those lovely, lovely words, Penny. I really appreciate it. So for the coaching work, my website is www.adamtallamy.com. That's A-D-A-M-T-A-L-L-A-M for mother Y.com. And for the manifestation art, it's just manifestation-art.com. And you can contact me, just drop me a line or an email, and, yeah, I'd love to talk to you, and always happy to just have a chat if you're not sure or you've got any questions about it. Don't hesitate.
Sam, thank you so much. Cool. Thanks, and I'm sure we'll talk again.
We will. Thanks, Penny. Appreciate it.
Good night. Bye. Good night.